Great to see you here again. This is another video related to algorithms. And in this video or series of videos, we will be looking at the growth of functions. We also call it big O, big omega, and big theta. Now look at functions, and we see when we are putting more data to calculate, we will see that the time to complete the calculations increases. And it's very important that we find out how is that growth of functions going. And when we looked at the examples before, we already noticed that some of these algorithms had less iterations than others to finish the work. It is clear to understand that when there are less operations to complete, it also means that there is less time to complete the calculation. And time, of course, is of the essence when we're looking at computers, certainly when we are working in real-time circumstances. We want to have the result very quickly. And we've seen with the growth of internet, with the growth of data, gathering data, big data, we get more and more data points to evaluate, and we have to find out what are the best algorithms to use. And growth of function is, in fact, very important. Now, it's not only the algorithm itself, but it's also the hardware and the software that are used to do the calculations. Now, it's very easy to understand when you buy a faster computer, that computer will do certain tasks faster. The hardware that we have is very important. We have also the configuration of the hardware, because in some cases, the configuration of the hardware or the way the computer or the computer system is dealing with data can also have an important impact on the algorithm and the duration of the algorithm. Another element related to the hardware is memory storage. More memory in certain cases, algorithms may need more memory because of the way they are dealing with the data. The software itself, of course, we write the algorithms in the software, and there we find out that the operations can be faster when we have a better software or a better way to deal with the algorithms. There are different languages that we can use, and some languages are better for certain types of calculations than others. The computer does the calculation faster, but the speed of the computer itself does not depend on the number of data points that I am considering. Basically, when we're looking at this, we're talking about a constant which is fixed for that specific computer or for that fixed system. Let's now introduce the notation of big O. Big O is in fact an important parameter because it gives us the upper border of the number of calculations. Now, when we have an algorithm and we want to understand how the algorithm works, we want to know how does the time to calculate or the number of iterations that we have to complete the algorithm, how it grows when the number of data increase. And when we look at big O, it's in fact the upper bound of the calculations, and it's typically the running time that will never be exceeded. So the algorithm will always be finished in less than that amount. Now, when we look at two algorithms, and one is given by a relationship between the number of iterations and the number of data, and that relation is 150n squared plus 23n plus 5. So when we have different values of n, the number of iterations to complete the algorithm can be calculated using this formula. A second algorithm has another relationship, which is 15n to the third plus 2n plus 3. When we compare the two, you can put them in an Excel table and do the calculations and start calculating the number of iterations. We see that the first algorithm has a higher value than the second one. So we have 150n squared plus 23n plus 5 up to the value n equal 11 is higher than 15 n to the third plus 2 n plus 3. Now, this is an indication that at the beginning, when we look at lower numbers, that the first algorithm takes longer while the second one is slower. But from number of data equal to 11, we see that this inverses. Now, when we look at those two elements, the first algorithm will have less iterations than the second, but only from n are larger than 11. So the moment that n reaches the border value of 11, the second algorithm will take more iterations to complete, hence more time. Now, basically, when we continue, when we look further and n increases further, what happens is that the relative importance of the lower order terms compared to the highest order term decreases. And basically, when n becomes large enough, we can replace 150 n squared plus 23 n plus 5 by the first term, 150 n to the square. We can do the same thing for the second one. So when n is large enough, we can replace this expression by 15 n to the third. Now, what we basically see on the difference of a constant, we see that the first iterations are given by a quadratic term and the second by a third degree term. And we consider these the time complexity. So basically, we will say that for the first algorithm, we will see that the growth of the function is like n squared, the big O is like n squared. And for the second one, the big O is like n to the third power. Now, let's have a look at how we define exactly big O. Now, we have here in an n time frame, we find here the red line, which is in fact the running time of the function itself. The green line is in fact another function, which from a certain moment n0 is always larger than the previous one. When we look at the expressions we had before, we can say that the green line was the relationship n to the third, while the red line was the relationship n to the square. And we saw there from 11, the point 11, we see that the third power function, third degree function, is always higher than the function of the square. Now, we can define the big O for this function that we have for values for n larger than n0, we can say that the upper bound is always higher than the running time of the function itself. So when we look at the growth of the function, when we look at 15 n to the third power plus 2 n plus 3, we can say from a value n0, and when we say at that time, the growth will be 20 times n to the third power, and this will be always larger from a value n0. We can determine that value, and we can determine that constant. It could also be 15, not 15, but 16, 17. Any number, any constant which is larger than 15 could be used here, which is the constant k. Basically, we find here that big O for 15 n to the third plus 2 n plus 3 is in fact n to the third. And that's how we define big O. On the other hand, we may also have big omega and big theta. Now, big omega is in fact the lower bound of the algorithm. And we do the same thing, but now from a number n larger than in zero, we can write that 10 n to the third power is always smaller than 15 n to the third plus 2 n plus 3. So basically, we can say that big omega is also n to the third power. Now, basically, in algorithms, we don't really care so much about the lower bound, but we are more interested in the upper bound, which is big O. Now, there is also another element that we can go further, which we call big theta. And when big theta, we can find, in fact, an upper bound and a lower bound. And the upper bound and the lower bound are only different with a constant. So it's the same function. In this case, it should be n to the third. So the lower bound is 10 times n to the third power, and the upper bound is 20 times n to the third power. So in this case, C2 is in fact 20, and C1 is 10. Now in this case, we have both upper and lower bounds. It's not always the case, but like I said, it would be nice to have big theta. In many cases, we are happy with big O, because we want to know the upper bound of the calculation. We want to do what is the longest time we can expect that an algorithm will run. So that was the introduction of the big O notation. What is the big O, the upper bound of the algorithm? We also want to look at big omega and big theta, but we will go further in the next session where we look deeper into the meaning of big O and how we can apply it to our different algorithms. I'm looking forward to seeing you there. Thank you and bye-bye.